So, welcome to the next session on numerical methods. And we are still in this larger, say, chapter on the Monte Carlo method. We will have maybe one or two more sessions in this one. And today I like to start a new section. Yeah, so we looked at Monte Carlo integration, uniform random number generation. We had an excursion into parallelization. And today I like to discuss a little bit how can we generate drawings, so random number sequences of other distributions. And I would like to start this section, say, with some motivation. So it's also maybe a small recap of some applications in mathematical finance, which we will use to demonstrate the methods. So the Monte Carlo method, which we discussed so far, approximates an expectation. So we approximate an expectation by a sequence of IID random variables. Okay, so we have that the Monte Carlo, say we called it the Monte Carlo integral, approximates the expectation. So 1 divided by n, the sum from I from 0 to n minus 1 xi converges to expectation x for a sequence xi of iid random variables having the same distribution as x. Okay, and you know that actually we use this theorem or this result actually on a single omega to then approximate the expectation by a sequence of random numbers, which we interpret as xi of omega. And we already noted that the same holds for a random variable set I, which is the function of xi. So then f of xi, the Monte Carlo integral, so 1 divided by n, the average of f of xi, converges to the expectation of f of x. So this converges to the expectation of the random variable z if f of x is integral, so if the expectation exists. And we use this result as Monte Carlo integration of f for the special case where the random variable x was uniform distributed. So we use this result for uniform distributed x because then we can interpret the expectation of f of x as an integral of f. And that was our integration method. Okay, so now let's take a look at this expectation again. So we are interested in calculating expectation f of x. And actually, in many applications, we would like to calculate such an expression, expectation of f of x, when x has a distribution which is different from the uniform distribution. So in many applications, we like to calculate expectation of a function of a random variable x, where x has a distribution which is different from the uniform distribution. Okay, so for example, we could look at x being normal distributed or exponential distributed or gamma distributed or whatever, many applications. Okay, in that case, we can still apply this theorem. So our interpretation of Monte Carlo integration was just a special case. So we can still use the approximation, the expectation of f of x. It can be approximated by a sequence over iid random variables, f of xi, iid random variables. And we approximate this, say, random variable by just taking one value. And you know that our result holds in probability. Yeah? So this is then just evaluating this at the single value, xi of omega, which is then our sequence of random numbers. So here we have a sequence of random numbers, f of xi. And now this sequence here can have a distribution. So this means this is a sequence of samplings, of drawings, of a random variable, which has a distribution which is different from the uniform one. So we are now interested in how do we generate in the computer a sequence of random numbers which is different from the uniform distribution, so which has maybe a given distribution function. So this is what we like to discuss today. Yeah? So we are interested in generating sequences of random numbers xi being drawings of x, where x has a given distribution. For example, normal, exponential, gamma, whatever. Okay, so examples for such distributions are the normal distribution, so with a given mean and a given standard deviation. So our sequence depends maybe on some parameters, mu and sigma, or the exponential distribution with a given intensity. I will also maybe recap a little bit the interpretation of what is an exponential distribution, how do we, why do we need it later. But first, let me give you an example of the classical application in mathematical finance, where the normal distribution is relevant to us or appears. Okay, so an example for the application is the universal pricing theorem. Yeah, so actually, it should be universal valuation theorem, which states that the value of a derivative, the value of a derivative is given as an expectation, namely the value at time t, at time little t. So this is the value of the derivative in little t, can be obtained by, if you know the value at a future time, say the value in capital T, then we have this relation that today's value is the expectation of the future value, given that this future value is multiplied with this ratio of the numerators, so n of t divided by n of capital T. So, and the numerator is just some kind of reference asset in which you measure the wealth or the value of objects. Yeah? So instead of saying that something is measured in euros or in dollars, you say that it's measured in terms of bananas, yeah, whatever. It's a reference asset. So actually, you maybe recall that this just means that V divided by N is a martingale. Okay, so this means V divided by N is a martingale. So a martingale with respect to which measure? To actually with respect to this measure here, Qn. So V divided by N is a Qn martingale. And you see this measure actually depends on which reference asset you choose. Yeah, it's like in physics, yeah, your reference frame, your reference system, which is moving, yeah, and all motion is relative to this frame. Yeah, and more or less this theorem tells us that the expectation of V relative to our frame is a martingale. So in expectation, it does not move. Okay, so this is the famous or important universal pricing theorem, telling us that we can express today's value as an expectation of a future value. Okay, now you think that this is maybe a strange theorem because the future value is uncertain, unknown, is a random variable. So today's value is maybe known. Yeah. So how do we know the future value V of T? And for that, we actually have two parts. In many applications here in derivative pricing, we know that the future value is a function, for example, a payoff function, of some other underlying quantity. For example, if you take the case that we like to value a call option on the stock, so we are in the situation that we like to evaluate a call option on some underlying stock, then you know that this V of T is, in this case, the maximum of F S of T minus K and zero. So this is actually the definition of the payoff of this option. Yeah, so V of T is maximum. So we know something happens in the future. We pay you the maximum of S of T minus K and zero. Yeah, so this is the option payoff. Yeah, so if this here is S, and this is V of T, and this is S and T, then I pay you nothing if we are below a certain constant, and otherwise you get a linear payoff function. Okay, so, and the second part is then that we have to specify what do we expect is S of T in the future. So expect is maybe not the correct word. Yeah. So what is possible for S of T in the future? So we have to define some kind of model for S of T. So if we put this model aside, so I will specify it on the next slide, then here we have that today's value of this call option is the expectation of a function G of some random variable S of T. Okay, so we have the case that we like to calculate the expectation of a function of a random variable. And here the random variable S of T is likely not uniform distributed. Yeah, it is the possible values of a stock in the future. So it has some other distribution. Okay, so the next step in this framework is to specify a model for S of T. Yeah. So what do we believe are reasonable values for S of T? And here I have an example, the Black-Scholes model for the asset S of T. So this model specifies a log normal distribution for S of T. So log normal distribution for S of T means that log S of capital T is normal distributed. So log normal distribution means that log of S of T is normal distributed. And this model tells us that the normal distribution has some mean. Yeah? So the mean is actually say today's value of the logarithm of S plus some shift, yeah, which depends on time, and R is an interest rate parameter, and then it has some sigma times some other random variable W. Yeah? So, and this W here is a normal distributed random variable. So a constant times a normal distributed random variable is normal distributed with a different standard deviation. And adding a constant to a normal distributed random variable is still normal distributed with a different mean, yeah, with a different expectation. So these two parameters or these two paths you see here, actually this little scaling here and this little addition here is just modifying standard deviation and mean. Apart from this, logarithm is normal distributed. So the S of t is log normal distributed. And you can take the exponential of this equation, yeah, and then you get a function for S. So you get an expression for S of t if you take the exponential on both sides. So S of t is S of 0 times exponential of this expression. And I replace this clumsy W, this clumsy, this is the Brown in motion. So this normal distribution here by an X. And you see that also S in this model can be written as a function of some random variable X where X has normal distribution. So I have that S of t is some h of x where x is normal distributed. Okay, actually it is normal distributed with mean zero and standard deviation square root of t. Yeah, it's the Brown in motion. We will discuss it later again. So actually x is square root of t times z and z is a standard normal. Okay, so now on these two slides, we started by the value of the derivative is an expectation of a function of a random variable, namely the distribution of the stock at the future time. The value of the stock at this future time is also a known function, our model of a random variable. So to summarize, we have that the value of the stock today, V of t, is an expectation. So I have here the expectation operator of some function. So this is the function g of some other function, which is the h of a random variable, which is the x. Okay, so and I have two functions. Of course, you can write this is just f of x, and f is the concatenation of g and h. But actually, I distinguish the two functions here because in my derivation, they had different meaning. So g defines the financial product, which we like to evaluate. So it is the function which describes the payment, the payoff, as a function of the market quantities like the stock. Then H defines the model for our market quantity, say the stock. And the X was our, say, risk driver. So it was the object that inside the model of S created the, I have to choose a different color here. So inside the model for S, X created the randomness. So actually X is the source of randomness. Okay, so G, the payoff function, a known function. H, the mathematical model, modeling how the stock behaves in the future. And X, a random variable, generating the randomness inside this function. So we are in this situation. And clearly here in this example, the model used a random variable X having a normal distribution, so not uniform distribution. So this is a classical application. And actually, after this session, you can already implement a Monte Carlo valuation of the Black-Scholes model. Yeah? We have all tools at hand now by using this little motivation here. Okay, there are, of course, other situations when we like to generate distributions, random variables, sampling random variables, so random numbers with different distributions. So more generally, in this example, the W was a Brownian motion at a specific future point in time, because there was only one interesting point in time, namely the capital T. In more complex situation, like for example, options which have different times with things happening, yeah, like an Asian option which takes the average over certain times, we need actually to simulate a Brownian motion for different times. So that is, we need to generate Brownian increments for a time discretization. And every such increment is normal distributed. So actually we need to generate a vector of a vector valued normal distribution. So we will discuss this later when we will discuss stochastic processes. Another example where we will encounter later another distribution is that of default times. So when a company goes bankrupt, you can specify a model that the default time follows actually an exponential distribution. So it's exponential distribution with some intensity lambda. Yeah, it's another example. And in the multifactor LIBOR market model, you have a vector valued Brownian motion with a given correlation matrix. So even more complicated, and there are other examples. For example, the variance gamma model. So needs a gamma distribution. Or you can also generate it by other means, and so on. Yeah, so there are many mathematical models where actually the randomness is generated by some random variable with a different distribution. Okay, so now how do we generate drawings, so random number sequences, with a given distribution different from the uniform one? So if you look into random number generators, then you see that random number generators usually give you the sequence as an uniform distributed sequence on 0, 1. So I just assume that we have such implementations. We already discussed them. And I will now discuss how can we use such a sequence and generate a sequence of a different distribution, given that we know some things of the random variable for which we like to generate these sequences. The things we need to know sometimes depends. So actually the easiest thing is if you know the inverse of the distribution function, but that's not always the case. But there are also methods that work if you just know the density and maybe some little bit more. Yeah, and we will discuss two such techniques. Okay, so I assume we have a uniform distributed sequence, or maybe something in this direction, like a quasi-random number generator. And I would like to start with this, say, maybe the most popular, and maybe also, in my opinion, maybe the best thing you could do, the inversion of the distribution function. Okay, so maybe just recall a distribution function. Or is it on the next slide? No. So a distribution function of a random variable x is a function f of little x, which is given by the probability that the random variable capital X is less than little x. Okay, so that's our distribution function. Let's have a little example. So, for example, the uniform if x is uniform on 0, 1, then this function looks like this. So say here is little x, here is 0. Yeah, the probability that our random variable is less than 0 is 0. So I have a 0 here. And then the probability that our distribution function is less than, say, that our random variable is less than 1 is 1. So I have a 1 here. Yeah, and less than anything which is larger than 1 is 1. And in between, it's a linear function. Yeah, it's the Lebesgue measure, dx is just equal to 1, though the slope is 1. Okay, so that's a distribution function. So assume that we have the distribution function of x, so we know this function. Can we then generate a sequence of drawings of x from a sequence of drawings of the uniform distributed random variable, so a random number generator which has uniform distribution. Okay, and yes, we can do this if we don't have f of x, if we have the inverse. So the method which I will present now needs the inverse of f of x. So now you see here on this little picture that actually the function is monotone, but it's not strictly monotone. So it is constant here. So actually an inverse does not exist, yeah, in the strict sense. We have to generalize the definition of an inverse. So there are some points x which get the same value y. Yeah, and we have to specify what should happen in this case. So before we can specify how the inverse of a distribution function allows us to generate the sequence, actually I have to define what is the inverse of a distribution function. So this is now a generalization of the definition of the inverse. So given some distribution function f, okay, we define the inverse of the distribution function by actually taking the infimum, so f to the power of minus 1 of y, yeah? So f maps x to y, so f inverse maps y to x. So f inverse of y is the infimum of all x, where f of x is larger or equal than y. And we define this for y between 0 and 1 on the open set, 0 and 1 not included. Okay, so what is this? So it's an infimum of a set. So in case there is some non-uniqueness, yeah, there are multiple points, actually this infimum of a set will pick a specific value. And let's illustrate what's happening here with a little picture. So on the left, I have a distribution function. So actually, this is a little bit like a piecewise uniform distributed one. Okay. So, and let's copy the definition from the other slide. So F inverse of Y is the infimum of the set X, so all the values X, for which F of X is larger equal than Y. Okay, so let's check. Yeah, that was our definition. Okay, so what's happening? So for a given value Y, say for example, I take that value here, Y. Okay. I take all the X for which F of X is larger than that value. No? So actually these are these X's here. And since the function is monotone, yeah, everything to the right belongs to this set. Okay, so maybe I draw it a little bit nicer here. Everything to the right belongs to this set. And from this set, I take the smallest value. And clearly this value is actually what the inverse should be. Because in this case, yeah, we have uniqueness. Okay, so actually we are in this situation. We map Y to this X here. Okay, so for the case where we have non-uniqueness, say we have this Y here. So then I take all the values for which F of X is larger or equal. Yeah. So please note there is an equal here. Larger or equal. So I include also this part here and all the other guys. Okay. And from this set, I choose the smallest point. So I choose this one. So going from here to the X, yeah, is actually like going from here to the X. And I take the smallest X, so I take that point. Yeah? So whenever in this, say, right-hand picture, you have a vertical line where the function would be not unique, I take the smallest value. Yeah? So I take the lowest point. Okay. So note that there's one small important part, which we will also see later in the implementation when we go to the computer, that we do this definition here on the open set. Okay, so Y is between 0 and 1. So it's on the set where you have positive probability. So the point minus infinity, yeah, so which is here, is not included. Yeah. So we will not map to minus infinity. So otherwise, if Y equals 0 would be included, F of X is always greater than equal 0. Yeah. So then the map would map to minus infinity. Okay. So, yeah, important. It's on the open set. So now we have a definition of an inverse of the distribution function. So now we can state this little lemma, yeah, which I already mentioned, that this helps us to generate a sequence of random variables, random samplings with a given distribution, or talking in terms of random variables, given a random variable u, which has uniform distribution. So let u be uniform on 0, 1. Let f be a given distribution function. So f is a given distribution function. Then the random variable x, which is f inverse of the u, of the uniform u, this one has distribution function f. So I can generate a random variable with distribution function f. So an f-distributed random variable can be generated from this sequence. Oops, sorry. If this distribution function f is continuous, then you can say invert the process. And if you apply f of x, so f to x again, you get again a uniform distributed random variable. Okay, but this last step is not so important for us. Yeah, this is a nice lemma. So if we have, say, for example, f inverse in closed form, if we have some function in the computer that implements f inverse, we just plug our uniform random number sequence in this function and we get an f distributed sequence. So before we play around with this lemma, and I also show you some issues in the computer, let's prove this lemma. So first, recall again that x has distribution function f if the probability of x less than x, yeah, so capital X less than little x, is just f of x, this distribution function. So we have a generalized inverse. So f inverse is not a classical inverse. So we don't have that if y is f of x, then x is equal to f inverse of y. But we have this result with a less or equal sign. So we have that if f inverse of y is less or equal x, then this is equivalent to f of x is larger than equal y. So actually, maybe it's not so nice, I flipped x and y, yeah? But you see that you can just apply f inverse or f to this inequality on the left-hand side, and you get the right-hand side. Yeah? So maybe it would be nicer if I would write here, say, y is less or equal f of x, and here f inverse of y is less or equal x. Yeah? So you can apply f to the inequality and f inverse cancels, or you can apply f inverse to the inequality on the right hand side, and f inverse f cancels. Okay, so why does this hold? Actually, I have to maybe show this. So this follows because in the definition, so there's a number here, definition 28. So this was our definition of the inverse. The infimum is attained. And the infimum is attained by right continuity of the function f. So maybe I copy here on the top, say the definition of f inverse of a given y, because I don't remember it. So it is the infimum of all values x such that f of x is larger or equal y. So from these, I take the smallest one. So that's our f inverse. And now it's claimed that we have right continuity and the infimum is attained. So the infimum is attained This means actually the infimum is part of the set. And we have right continuity of F. So maybe let me elaborate here on this a little bit. So the infimum is attained means if X is the infimum and we have a sequence X plus epsilon is in this set for all epsilon greater zero, then X is in this set. So actually this means that I can write minimum instead of infimum. Okay. So, and for the second part, right continuity, yeah. So, why is now the infimum attained? So, right continuity. So, let's look at F of X plus an epsilon. So f of x plus epsilon distribution function, this is the probability that our random variable capital X is less or equal x plus epsilon. Okay, this is a set, yeah, the set of omega where x is smaller or equal x plus epsilon. So I can decompose this set into two parts, the part where x or the omega where x is less or equal little x, and the set where x is larger than x, but smaller and equal x plus epsilon. So it is in the open set x to x plus epsilon. So, and these are, this is a decomposition into a set, yeah, which do not have an intersection. So then this is the probability of x less or equal than x plus the probability of x being in this set. And now I have that the limit for epsilon going to zero, yeah, from the right, okay, so epsilon is positive, of this probability x x plus epsilon. Okay, this is just the probability of the empty set because I'm left open. On the left hand side, I'm open. And this is zero. Yeah, so I have continuity. Yeah, in the limit, I have exactly f of x. And you see that actually this here is due to having the open set here. Okay, otherwise there could be a single x in this set. And this is due to the fact that actually here we have a less than equal. Here we have a less than equal. So actually in this definition of the distribution function, we had here a less than equal. So otherwise you can do the proof again with the left continuity. Yeah, but actually now we have right continuity and we have this definition with the infimum and the infimum is attained. So infimum is attained means that I can write minimum here. So why does this now imply that actually this number six here, yeah, so which I have to show holds? Okay. So let's write this here on the left part of the little box here. So let's go from left to right. Yeah? So from left to right. So I have that f to the power of minus one, f inverse of y is less or equal x. Okay. Then I just plug in the definition of f inverse. So the definition is it is the infimum of this set, but from our little box on the right, I can show you it is the minimum. Yeah? So I have that this actually tells me that the minimum of this set. So the set of all xi for which f of xi is larger equal y, this minimum is less or equal x. It's just I plugged in the definition of this f. So let's call xi this minimum. So let this here be a xi, with a little bit ambiguity. I call the minimum just c. This xi is inside this set. So first I have that this xi is less or equal x, because this is just what is written here. Yeah, it's less or equal x. But then, in addition, the xi is inside the set, because the infimum is attained. So I also have that f of xi is larger and equal y. Okay. So now I need this part here, which is just the fact that f is monotone. So if xi is less than equal x, then f of xi is less than equal f of x. Okay, so I have from that maybe I take another green here. Okay, so I have from that that also f of xi, or maybe here I have f of xi is less or equal f of x. Okay, so let's clean it a little bit up. So together, we have f of xi is less than f of x, and y is less than f of xi. So I have that y is less than f of x, which is what we like to show here. Okay, so now the other way around, let's go backward. I hope I have enough space here to do this. Yeah, but this is the easy part. If f of x is larger and equal y, so this is here the right-hand side. Okay, then actually it means that x is in this set because x is here in this set, because it is the set of all xi for which this holds. Yeah? So it means that x is in this set. And of course, the minimum of this set is then smaller than x. So it means the minimum of this set of all values is smaller and equal x. Yeah? So it's smaller and equal. Yeah? Okay, so which is this part here, the minimum is smaller or equal x. And you know that, this part here was just the definition. Okay, so now we proved this orange little result that actually our inverse behaves a little bit like an inverse, but not with an equal sign, with a less than equal sign. Yeah, so FF inverse cancels in this inequality. Okay, so that we don't have an equal sign is the price of this generalization, that we have a certain kind of non-uniqueness. Okay, so maybe that was a little bit a prologue to actually what we like to prove. Let's go back to the lemma. So what we like to prove is we have a uniform distributed random variable u, and if we apply f inverse, we get a random variable x which has distribution function f. Okay. So we have a uniform distributed random variable u, u. This means that we also know the distribution function of the random variable u. Yeah, so this random variable has the distribution function g of x, which I had drawn before. Yeah, so it's the distribution function of the uniform distribution, 0, 1. So like that. Okay. So it means that the probability that capital U is less than little u, so the probability that the uniform distributed random variable is less or equal than a given number u is g of u. And if now u is in 0, 1, this is just equal to u. Yeah? Inside u, inside 0, 1, it's just a linear function, it's just the identity. Okay, but we like to check the distribution function of x. So let x be in R, arbitrary, and the distribution function we like to check is that of capital X. So what is P of capital X less or equal little x? So first, by the definition of capital X, this is the inverse of the u using the inverse of the distribution function. So it's f inverse applied to u. Yeah? So we just apply here the f inverse of the u, less or equal x. And now I use the result number 6. So our orange result number 6. So what was that? It was that the inverse function here, so it was here applied to a y, behaves like an inverse, so we can apply just f to it and we get f f inverse is y on this inequality is less or equal f of x. So I can do this and apply this for every omega. Yeah. So actually here inside this little part here is actually, it's a set. Yeah, it's a set of all omegas for which f inverse of u of omega is less or equal a given little x. Yeah. And I can then call this here little u. Yeah, this is the capital U. And I can then call this little u. So I apply this for every omega. So I get that this is equal to the probability that u is less or equal a given number, namely f of little x. So, but this is just the distribution function of u with some given number. And we had here from this red part, yeah, that this is the identity. So this is just f of x. So we have proven that the probability that x is less or equal than little x is just f of x. So capital X has distribution function capital F. Sorry. So we have shown our result. Okay, so that's a very nice lemma. Once we have this function, we can generate a random variable, and in our case, a random number sequence with a given distribution function. Okay. So let's discuss this a little bit. Yeah, actually, I believe this lemma is maybe the most favorite ones in generation of random number sequences. It's quite important. Yeah, and it works tremendously well. Yeah, but there are a few things, a few issues, and yeah, maybe you will. We will have also a small code session in a few minutes, and you will see some of these. So first of all, the method appears to make a quite strong assumption. Namely, that we know the inverse of this distribution function, actually the generalized inverse, analytically. So the ICDF, inverse cumulative distribution function, that we know it analytically. However, in many situations, there is no analytic formula for the inverse of the cumulative distribution function. I will comment again on this in one of the other slides, but the normal distribution is an example and it's very important to us. So what can you do? So often you have very fast approximations. Yeah, usually fast approximations of this distribution function exist. Sometimes of the inverse exist. Sometimes you have maybe a better formula for the distribution function and not a nice formula for the inverse. And in that situations, or also in the situations where you have no formula at all, it's somewhat tempting to improve this numerical accuracy by using a numerical method. So you use some numerical approximation of an integral, or for example, you use some root finder, some inversion to improve the approximation of the ICDF, of the inverse of the distribution function. But actually this is often a bad idea, and it's sometimes better to use an approximation which is maybe not 100% accurate and leave it that way. And the reason why I make this comment is that in many applications you can actually control such an error, or you can reduce it by other means. So such an inaccuracy in the approximation is often very good to control. And remember our motivation, the normal distribution popped up in the Black-Scholes model. So it was a model of the future values, of the future possible values of the stock. But actually it's just a model. Yeah. So it's for sure that the future values of the stocks are not exactly log normal distributed. So if you just use now some other way to approximate this distribution, it's actually just that you use a slightly different model. And in these models, for example, if we go back to our motivation, so which was here, in these models you have here parameters like the sigma, the standard deviation in front of the normal distribution. And this parameter is often calibrated to observed values. That is, you choose the parameter to match observed values, which we observe on the market. And now, if this random number generator here has some error, and you have this calibration process, actually, the calibration process will choose a slightly different parameter to match the observed value. So actually, the process of calibration is sometimes removing inaccuracies you have in such numerical approximations. Okay, so that was here a small remark. So actually it's here called a tip. Yeah. So sometimes it's okay to leave these approximations as they are, because you have some kind of calibration that remove this error. There are also situations where it's not okay. These are the situations where you use an analytic formula for your model, which is derived from the strict assumption that the distribution is as it is specified by the model. Yeah, so then you have a mismatch between analytic formulas and your numerical method. Yeah? And you have to be aware of where this mismatch actually occurs. Okay, but I have another remark that for the normal distribution, so example, normal distributed random variable, I would like to now apply this method. So for a standard normal distributed random variable X, so this was our example with the Black-Scholes model. Actually, their X had standard deviation square root of T, and the Z was standard normal. We know something analytically. So we know, for example, the density is known analytically. Okay, 1 divided by 2p exponential, square root of 2p exponential minus x squared half. Density is known analytically. The distribution function is the integral is not known analytically, and the inverse is also not known analytically. So we do not have an analytic closed form solution of F inverse. However, now in our course, our first sessions were on computer arithmetic. And we discussed in this course the IEEE 754 standard for floating point precision. Okay. And recall that in arithmetic operations, we had the term of exact rounding. So if you have a floating point number in your computer and you apply a function, for example, the exponential function, then it's not guaranteed that the result is in the set of floating point numbers. So the computer will perform a rounding. And such an operation has exact rounding if it is guaranteed that the result returned by the implementation is the closest one to the true result. And you cannot get anything better. And the function which were conforming to this standard were guaranteeing exact rounding. For example, our exponential function is having exact rounding. And now you find papers where you find approximations of the inverse of the distribution function for the normal distribution, where the approximation guarantees that the approximation error is smaller than the machine precision, for example, for the floating point double precision number. In our case, this was 10 to the minus 16. So, for example, here in this paper by Vichura from 1988, you find an algorithm, and this algorithm is guaranteeing this, and it's using an approximation using piecewise rational functions. Actually, I have the code in our Java library, and you can have a look at this. And this implementation is actually guaranteeing that the error of the approximation is smaller than machine precision. So with respect to what we have in the computer, it's actually analytic. So, which is a very nice result. So I have an implementation which has sufficiently, which is sufficiently accurate. We cannot get better in terms of floating point numbers. Then I have another small remark on this method, a small warning. It's actually maybe rarely relevant, but actually I stumbled across this from time to time. And if you don't know what's going on, maybe it's important to have seen this. When I proved the lemma, and when I actually was stating the lemma, we had here the remark that this is the open set. Okay. So this lemma here holds for a uniform random number sequence in this open set. So now it's important to actually check the implementation of your inverse of the cumulative distribution function, your F inverse, and the implementation of the random number generator with respect to the domain. For example, many random number generators generate random numbers between 0 and 1, 0 included, 1 not included. So what's happening to your inverse of the cumulative distribution function if you have an argument being zero, or if you have an argument being one? Maybe there's some canonical way to do it. Yeah? So you could map zero to minus infinity and one to plus infinity. Yeah. And this also happens in some implementations. For example, the implementation in the mathematical library, Java library, Apache Command Math version 3.6.1, yeah, which is the current version, does exactly this. If you would like to have the inverse of the normal distribution function at zero, you get double negative infinity. Yeah, our floating point numbers have these values. If you apply it to one, you get double positive infinity. Okay, that's a reasonable result. But if your calculation then continues with this result, it may have some unpleasant effect. So you have to check the behavior of the transformation, yeah, the behavior of the inverse cumulative distribution function. And you have it in the context of your specific random number generator. Yeah, because some random number generators generate the numbers on the set, zero included, one not included. And we also learned about quasi-random number generators. For example, the first element of the Sobol sequence is zero. Yeah? So if you have a Sobol sequence and you apply this method, the first element of your normal distributed sequence is minus infinity. How can he measure that if it is limited by the machine precision? You mean the paper? So there is a question in the chat. So yes, so the machine precision is known. Yeah, the relative error is 10 to the minus 16. And actually he has a polynomial expansion. Yeah? And like in Taylor's formula, you know the remainder of this expansion. And he can then just estimate that the remainder is accurate enough. Yeah. So maybe we can have a closer look to this paper in another session, or discuss how such approximations are derived. So, but the point is that we know the machine precision. So actually it's not for general machine precisions. The paper states that his formula is accurate up to 10 to the minus 16. And we know that the relative error of double floating point is 10 to the minus 16. So it is okay for floating point double numbers. If you have higher accuracy, you need a higher accurate approximation formula. Okay, so what's next? Yeah, let's do a small code session. Yeah? So we have a few minutes left. Actually, the thing which I would like to do here on the slides next is take a look at exponential distributed random variable, where you can derive this inverse also analytically. But maybe I would like to do a small code session on this here, also that you see that the method works and how it works. Yeah? Okay, so we are here in our code. And let's go back to the lemma. So I like to do a code session doing this lemma for the normal distribution. So the applying the inverse of the cumulative distribution function of the normal distribution to a uniform random number sequence gives us a normal distributed random number sequence. And maybe I do a new class here, a small playground, where we do this experiment. Let's call it normal ICDF experiments. I would like to have a main method where I do my experiments. We do it here in our section on random numbers, on our package on random numbers. And the first one is maybe we have Mersenne twister. So test ICDF with Mersenne twister is maybe a first thing I would like to do. So I do not have such a method. Let's create it. Yeah. So I just create methods for all my small experiments so that it's maybe a little bit cleaner here. Okay, so let's generate a Mersenne twister random number sequence. Okay, and so what do we need? Maybe I create a sequence of a few sample points, I from 0 to, let's say, 100,000, I plus plus, the next I. And the uniform random number is just taken from our random number generator. So get next double. Okay. Maybe I can print this. So let's print the index I, let's print a tab, let's print the uniform. Okay, so and let's run this so we see that we generate some uniform random numbers. So you see some uniform distributed random numbers between 0 and 1. So now let's take some inverse of the normal distribution function. I take actually the implementation which I mentioned from Apache Common Math. So there is actually, where is it? This is in distributions. There is a class normal distribution. Okay, so you have to actually create an object from this class. Okay, and once you have this object from this class, you can ask this object to perform some stuff, yeah, whatever. And there's a cumulative one, and there's also an inverse cumulative distribution function, inverse cumulative probability. And we apply it to the uniform. So that should be our normal. Okay, and maybe I print this also here in a table. So let's print the normal one. And so you see here we have the normal distributed in the second column. Yeah. So when we are smaller than 1/2, we get the negative side. When we are larger than 1/2, we get the positive side. Yeah, looks maybe reasonable. Maybe I can also plot this. To plot this, I have to put all the values in some list. So let's create here some list where I collect all the values which we generate here in some array list. So maybe I first plot the uniform ones. So let's put in our list the uniform number. And create a plot. Okay, I have here a small helper library where I can create plots. And there is a function create histogram, which just takes the values as a list, the number of points for your bucket discretization, it's a histogram, and the standard deviation for the size which you like to plot. Maybe we take 4 standard deviations, which we like to plot. And then you can just display this. Okay, this is just a small helper because plotting libraries are otherwise so clumsy. Yeah. And so we have to declare some exception here, which can happen if the plot cannot be shown. If you don't have a Windows system, for example, don't care. And let's run this now. Okay, so this should be now a plot of the uniform distributed samples. Okay, so you see here the uniform. You see it's not a straight line here. Okay, because it is a pseudo random number generator. Actually, it will look always different because I did not specify a seed. Yeah, so maybe I can specify some seed. Then it will always look the same. Okay, so let's do the same plot with now the normal. So I add here the normal distributed to my list. So this is now the list of normals, and I plot this. Okay, so now I have applied the inversion. Yes, it looks quite nice. It looks like a normal distributed random number sequence. Okay, so maybe try the same thing with a different sequence. Maybe I try the same with our van der Korput sequence. We had the van der Korput sequence. So test ICDF with van der Korput. Okay, so all I do here is I replace this now with the van der Korput sequence generator. I have to specify a base. Let's take base 2. So I specify here this Mersenne, is now something else. It's the van der Korput sequence. And let's call it here uniform sequence, because it's not the Mersenne. Okay, so now he's complaining here that the function next double does not, the method next double does not exist. It was because when we implemented this, the name of the method getting us the value had a different name. And that was maybe stupid. And and I have to call now our new test here to run it. So let's test it with the van der Korput sequence. So that looks very nice. Okay, let's do the same thing with just plotting the uniforms. So this is our test van der Korput. It generates a uniform sequence, and I like to plot the uniform of the van der Korput. So that was the result with the conversion. And this is our uniform from the van der Korput sequence. Yeah? So the van der Korput sequence was a quasi-random number sequence. It is actually filling the space very evenly. So you do not see this wiggling. Yeah. So you have a very smooth uniform distribution. And you also have a very smooth approximation of the normal distribution. So if you compare this now with the Mersenne, output we had, this was the Mersenne output. Then you see that the fact that we use a pseudo random number generator makes the curve a little bit more roughly because it's not filling the space evenly. There are sometimes clusters, sometimes we have open spaces. And this is then visible in the inversion. But recall that the randomness was not a bug, it was maybe a feature, and in higher dimensions, actually it can be that the pseudo-random number generator is still better. Okay, so you see from these pictures that the method works very nicely. Yeah, you generate with the transformation a normal distributed random variable. Okay, so I like to do the same maybe for the Sobol sequence. Yeah? So let's have these guys here disabled. And let's do test ICDF with Sobol sequence. I have a Sobol sequence generator lying around. So let's create this method. So I just copy here the code from the Mersenne. Yeah, doesn't matter. Yeah, it's always the same code. It's just one line which I change. Yeah, a lot of code duplication. Maybe you should not do this. So, and instead here of the Mersenne twister, I now take a Sobol sequence, and there's a Sobol sequence 1D, yeah, a one-dimensional Sobol sequence. Actually, Sobol sequences are good for higher dimension, and I call it here Sobol. Okay, so from this Sobol sequence, it's also a pseudo-random number generator. We generate here the next double value, which is a uniform. We apply the inverse of the normal distribution, and we write out some numbers, and then we like to plot it. Okay, so let's run our test with Sobol. Compilation error. What is the compilation error? Okay, I have to specify this exception. So let's run now the experiment with the Sobol sequence. And my plot is not showing up. My plot is empty. Okay, so I already told you the issue. Yeah? Let's just take the first 10 numbers. And you see that the Sobol sequence is actually very similar to the van der Korpus sequence. It is 0, 1 half, then it is 3 over 4, 1 over 4, and so on. It's very similar to the van der Korpus sequence, but it starts at 0. Yeah? So actually, the Sobol sequence is I divided by 2 to the power of n from I equals 0 to 2 to the power of n minus 1. So it's equidistributed for if the number of numbers we generate is a power of 2. Yeah? So it is in these special cases, it is equidistributed. Yeah. So here the first two numbers are equidistributed. This is the first four numbers are equidistributed, and then the first eight numbers are also equidistributed. I divided by n, and the I is from 0 to n minus 1. So the first number is 0. And this inversion here maps actually minus infinity, 0 to minus infinity. So that's actually here the specification of this implementation. And you have to check this stuff. Yeah? So we can fix it very easily because the Sobol sequence will never generate 1. And we know that 0 is the first value. So I can just remove this first value here by calling Sobol next double. Yeah? So I have consumed the first value, and then everything works. So let's take 100,000 values of the Sobol sequence. So you saw maybe it started at 0.5, the first value, and you have a very nice generation of a normal distribution with the Sobol sequence. Maybe to illustrate this pitfall once again, let's do the test with the Java random number generator, Java random. Okay. So let's copy this code here from the Sobol sequence, and let's do the same here. But now instead of the Sobol sequence, I use a new random. Yeah, let's take some seed. Yeah, so like 3141, whatever. So I call this sequence now. Let's import it. Random. Yeah, it's not Sobol. It's just Java random. So this is our linear concurrential random number generator, which we discussed before. Okay. So and let's run this. Yeah, it's also a pseudo random number generator. Also works very nicely. It's now a little bit rough because it is not a quasi, it's a pseudo random number generator. Okay. So, but if you now hover over here, this next double, you see the interface, you see the specification of this method. And here it tells us returns the next pseudo random uniform distributed double value between 0 and 1 from this random number generator uniformly from range 0 inclusive to 1 exclusive. So actually this implementation tells me that it could happen that 0 appears. So maybe it was just luck that our code worked. Actually, I believe with next double, it will not happen that the 0 appears, but if you use next float, it can happen. Yeah? And it happens quite often. Yeah? So let's use a float. So instead of precision 10 to the minus 16, we have now precision 10 to the minus 8, a little bit less. Yeah? And let's run the generator. It works. Okay. Let's take a different seed. I take 36, 36. Yeah? Let's run the generator and generate from the normals, from the uniform, the normals. And we don't get any output. Okay, so maybe we have to search a little bit, but if you take 37,000 numbers, the first 37,000 numbers, then you will see that the generator does not work. If you take 36,000 numbers, then it works. And if you browse here through the numbers generated. Okay, 36 works, 37 does not work. So let's run again 37. Then you see that at some place between 36 and 37, I have to search a little bit. Here, there was a 0 popping up. Okay. So I don't get any output here. Maybe as a last remark, I have an alternative implementation of the normal distribution. And that implementation is here, for example, so let's remove this one. So I have an implementation normal distribution in this library, which provides inverse cumulative normal distribution Vitura from this paper. So let's use that one. Let's use that one to generate the normal. So now remember, this here is the seed where a 0 in between appears. Yeah. So actually, this is the thing which did not work before. Okay, so now I use this other implementation of the ICDF, and with this implementation, the code works. So what's happening? So that should be maybe another test. So test ICDF implementations. So let's create this method, and I just like to do one thing. Let's specify P, our uniform, as 0, yeah? And specify the normal as the inverse of this P, yeah? With this Vitura implementation, and also with the Apache Commons Math implementation. Okay, so that is, maybe I have to copy this code here. And use here this normal distribution inverse of the P. And now let's just print the values. So the P was P, and then print some tab, and the Vichura implementation. So, which is a specific implementation. Actually, it's just the formula from the paper, but this behavior here is part of the implementation and the commons math. So the Apache implementation gives us this value, and that's maybe my last test for today. And let's print this out. Then you see that for P equals zero, Apache gives us minus infinity, which is maybe correct because it is the correct mathematical value. The ICDF of zero for the normal distribution should be maybe minus infinity. But the Vichura implementation just gives us zero. Oh, that's maybe strange because zero is the value which we would expect from 1/2. But what he's actually doing is he's given us some value which is actually in this, when you do this transformation of the sequence, which is the most likely value, yeah, you are most likely around zero. So he gives us one additional value, zero, which doesn't harm. So from a mathematical point, this implementation here is maybe not 100% correct, because in the limit case, it gives us a value which is not the one which you would expect. But from the numerical point of view, he's actually fixing an issue that could occur in your random number generator. So that was maybe this remark here. I would like to go back to the slide and finish here that you have to actually check what is the implementation of your ICDF transformation and what is the implementation of the random number generator and how do they behave if they get together.